Hello, everybody. Today we are going to depart from terrestrial ecosystems, especially tropical rainforests, and we'll be looking at their marine analogy, which are coral reefs. Why analogy? It's the major concentration of biological diversity in the tropical seas. However, unlike rainforests, which are dominant ecosystem in tropical region, coral reefs are actually very limited in their spatial occurrence. And that's because for a coral reef to develop, there has to be a number of restrictive conditions satisfied. Coral reefs like high water temperature, above 14 degrees centigrade, so they are tropical. They also need to be in the euphotic zone because their mutualistic dinoflagellates are photosynthesizing. They need to be in areas with low nutrient concentration. Otherwise, their competitors, especially algae, will overgrow them. And then they need to be also in areas of low turbidity and sedimentation. Otherwise, they will be buried in the sediment because they grow slow. And so it's easy for them to be covered by the fast growing sediment layers. And finally, there has to be a water acidity, which is suitable to calcification, and so they have to have ACO3 available for building their structures. All this is causing corals to be quite restricted, and here we have their patterns of species diversity, which are centered on the what is called a coral triangle, and that's the area between New Guinea and Northwest Australia, continuing to Java, Sumatra, and in the north to the Philippines. So what are the coral reefs? Corals are colonial animals. They are polyps, and these polyps are forming large colonies. They are building a calcium carbonate skeletons and live symbiotically with photosynthesizing dinoflagellates. So this is how an individual polyp in the coral reef looks like. So they are filtering water for food, and this kind of organisms building calcareous skeletons currently are dominated by corals, anthozoa, but over the last 500 million years of history, there has always been some organisms building these structures, which nowadays we are calling coral reefs. In the past, this could be different taxa. Today it's anthozoa, used to be tabulata, rugosa, sclerotinia, depending on the geologic period. This is current morphological diversity of the calcareous structures of different corals, and this is how such a coral reef surface looks like. It has been likened to tropical rainforests, and there are indeed several similarities. First, there is a intense competition for space. As we have discussed, it's crucial for tropical forest trees to reach the canopy, and there is a strong competition for light. The same applies, to coral reef. There is also, therefore, very strong competition, which in corals is taking place using chemical weapons. There can be filaments and tentacles which are being sent to the neighbors, and there is a competitive hierarchy. So certain corals tend to win over other coral species. That this has been noticed that when you try to have corals in a tank, in aquarium, then it has been noticed that certain pairs of species are incompatible and one of them always dies, and that's because of this chemical competition. Corals are not only structure builders on the reefs. The second in importance are porifera, also very, very old group, which is morphologically diverse, again, filtrators and having a contribution to physical structure of the coral reefs. We mentioned that there is a photosynthetic algae mutualism with corals, and these dinoflagellates are associated with a large range of taxa in the seas. It's not only corals, anthozoa, but also radiolaria, foraminifera, sponges, porifera, sea anemones, also turbellaria, mollusca. Now, the coral reefs are important for diversity, not only corals themselves, but also nudibranchs, mollusks, fishes, lots of other taxa, simply because they are forming physical structure in the shallow seas, and so forming ideal environment with lots of niches. How they are doing that? We have these typical forms, either fringing reef, which is growing on the in shallow part of the island or continent, or barrier reef, or atolls. We will discuss how atolls originate later. There are some examples here. For instance, this is the fringing reef, which will finally develop in an atoll simply by the island in the middle being washed out by erosion. You can already see in this example how erosion is working here. While corals are living organisms, so they can build layer after layer of calcareous deposits, and therefore adjust to the sea level fluctuations and repair the damage due to erosion, unlike the islands themselves. This is an example of a reef in New Guinea, which looks unremarkable, but in shallow water in the area, you can see there is around 700 species of fish and about 800 species of nudibranchs, tens of species of corals, and so on, extremely rich ecosystem. The main gradient in coral reefs is the depth gradient, and so especially on the fringing reefs, where there is a reef crest, and then there is an outer reef slope, and then there is also shallow reef flat towards the island or the continent. And so this gradient in depth, it's not only light gradient, intensity of light, but also the gradient of disturbance intensity, mechanical disturbance by waves. And that predictably leads to, again, to series of different species, in this example of fishes, with different depth preferences along this gradient. There is also a morphological change in the corals themselves, from these flat, compact corals, which are quite resistant to damage by waves, and so they are in the most exposed environments, to these corals which are able to outgrow sedimentation, but at the same time are susceptible to mechanical damage. So there is a trade-off between being able to resist mechanical disturbance, but then be susceptible to sedimentation and vice versa. when we look at different morphologies of the corals, then this is the probability of colony dislodgement or damage, and which is high, especially at the crest of the reef. But then it's also different depending on the morphology of individual corals. This is an example of such an intense disturbance event, the hurricane. And again, we are looking at the trajectory of that coral reef, the percentage of life coral cover, which was somewhere around 30% initially. And then there was a big hurricane, which drove it almost to zero. And then there was again a recovery, which was again slowed down by another hurricane. And then after 11 years, it basically got to the point where it started. This coverage of the coral also corresponds to the number of species of corals and others. And we can see again something like disturbance intensity effect, where the middle values of life coral coverage correspond to highest number of species. Now, these are some drawings of how corals look morphologically with different life forms. And this is an Indo-Pacific coral reef, just to give you an idea. And these are some photographs from New Guinea. Again, the coral reef ecosystem. Sometimes the reefs can form monodominant areas of certain corals. Again, we can recognize soft and hard corals, again, with different resistance to disturbance. This is an example of such a soft coral area. And then this large formation here is actually a sponge. And then there is a large number of species of nudibranchs, which are very, very small, mollusks, which are often very vividly colored. This is often aposematic coloration, and which again can have several hundred of species on the coral reefs. When we look at the large scale diversity patterns, then just Indo-Pacific has about 3,000 reef species of fish, and that alone represents about 18% of global fish diversity. We already mentioned the coral triangle here, and then you can see that there are like contour lines of decreasing diversity going away from the coral reef triangle. There are different ecological niches filled by reef fishes. One specialized one are coralivores. When you dive on coral reef, you always hear sort of crashing background noise, and that's basically generated by fishes always crashing and eating corals. There is a distribution of food niches in fish fauna at different Pacific coral reefs. There is a lot of similarities here, and there are piscivores feeding on other fish, and then macroinvertebrate feeders, microinvertebrate feeders, most common ones, and then there are plankton and feeders, and the smallest group are detritivores. Some of the main families of coral reef fishes in the Pacific, and then this is we are going away from Pacific. This is example of visual example of coral reef fish diversity. Overall, the coral reef diversity globally represents the full quarter of marine biodiversity, despite corals representing only 2 or 3% of marine area. Some of the examples of food webs on coral reefs with different taxa serving as prey on the bottom line, and then the top line are 84 different fish families. So for instance, when you look at the violet block at the extreme left, these are other fishes. So these are piscivores, and you can see different importance in different ecosystems and number of fisheries feeding on other fish. Coral reefs require grazing of algae biomass unless they are growing in extremely low nutrient environment. And there is a problem that if the algae successfully overgrow the reef, then there is a switch into alternative steady state of algal cover, which no longer supports fish diversity, including the fish grazers, which will normally reduce the algal cover. When we look at large-scale biogeography, there are the main boundaries for the fauna. So you can see, for instance, the Red Sea boundary and the Mediterranean. There is also one boundary in the middle of the Pacific, between East and West Pacific. And then there are a number of minor discontinuities in species composition. We already mentioned the coral reef triangle that applies not only to corals, but also to the associated diversity of the fishes. How it originated? Well, there are probably several factors. There is a suggestion that there has been a lot of speciation in the peripheral areas, and there is a sort of middle overlap of accumulating species. Then also that there is a speciation in the center as well, which is plausible considering the geographic diversity of number of islands there, and also shallow seas, which means that there is a lot of dynamics with fluctuating water level. We have to keep in mind that there is several tens of meters up and down variation in sea cover just in the last glacial periods. And then also that there is a refugium model that means that area has been favorable for coral reefs for a long time. The center of the fish diversity, so-called Indonesian and Philippine region, IPR, which shows not only the maximum in the tropics, the latitudinal peak, but also the longitudinal peak. So it's really this central area of the coral reef gradient between Borneo and the Philippines and New Guinea. And when we look at the diversity of the Pacific fish communities in wider region, these are the numbers here which were studied, then we see that the number of IPR species present is driving the overall species diversity of the fishes, and the locally endemic ones are rare and do not change in numbers with increasing total diversity of the community. So basically the diversity of fish community in the whole Indo-Pacific is dependent on how many IPR species were able to get there. And so there is really the diversity is diminishing in all directions from that IPR center. This is the map of the coral reef area in the past, and again we can see that historically there has been a long lasting favorable area in the coral triangle, and so again we can explain the current diversity of reef fishes by isolation from that center. There is the coral reef paleo distribution, and at these maps, this is relatively recent, less than 1 million years distribution, but we can see that at least for that period of time, the coral reefs there were stable, and they actually have been stable for over at least past 3 million years. These are distributions of geographic ranges for corals and fishes. They generally have large geographic ranges, with corals having especially large ones, with the juvenile stages of polyps dispersing with ocean currents everywhere. So here we can see the species diversity, of fishes and corals, and then, but then when we define somewhat arbitrarily endemic species as those on less than 100,000 square kilometers of the area, then suddenly there are pretty much no endemic corals, except some examples in the Red Sea. So corals are quite widespread. I already mentioned that current anthozoan corals is not the first time when we have these reef builders. Actually, last 500 million years always have some builders of the calcareous structures, but they can be either calcite or aragonite or magnesium calcite, and they can belong to different taxa. So we have algae, then we have bivalves with rudis as the most remarkable example. We have corals, again, we have sphaeractinians, but in the past we had rugosa, tabulate, and heliozoan corals. We have also sponges, and we already mentioned algae. So regarding the marine biodiversity hotspots, they also were moving. This is the current situation with Coral Triangle, which was pretty much the same still about 20 million years ago, except that there was another diversity center that was before the closure of the what is currently Red Sea. But then when we go to 40 million years ago, then there was actually these Red Sea maximum expanded to entire Mediterranean, and then the current Coral Triangle did not exist. In Porifera, we also have history of repeated calcifications, calcareous skeletons, again in different lineages and at different geographic times for the last 500 million years. These are some reconstructions of coral structures going 500 million years ago. And this is the 140 million years. This is the fossil record of rudis bivalves, which was a quite extraordinary type of what is sort of analogy ecologically to current coral reefs. Now, reefs, because of their sensitivity to the environment, to nutrient enrichment, concentration in small areas in shallow waters, which are coinciding to large extent with high population density of people, are very vulnerable. I would say more than rainforests. And so this is current map again around the coral reef triangle of the degree of endangerment of coral reefs, and the modeling shows that for a number of anthropogenic reasons that endangerment will be increasing, especially on the margins of larger islands. There are problems with coral bleaching that's responding to climatic changes, sudden changes in climate, which leads to corals losing their dinoflagellate mutualists. This is a natural dynamics, which leads to recovery of corals, but with more stress and climatic changes, we might have seen bleaching on increase, destructive fishing, including poisoning fish by cyanide, which is widely practiced in some regions and which kills also the corals. Then nutrients, especially from the agriculture on the continents, and sedimentation, which is also enhanced by logging operations and by agriculture. And then the last threat is increasing carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. There are also biotic threats like this Acanthaster plancy, predator specialized to corals. And again, it's a partly natural situation, but can be exacerbated by spread to new locations of Acanthaster. For the for the carbon dioxide, the problem linked to global warming is that the production of carbon dioxide means that there is a balance between the carbon dioxide dissolved in the salt water. So on a positive side, that means that the oceans have been absorbing most of the anthropically produced CO2, but it's dissolved and so produces bicarbonate HCO3 minus and then H plus, and then HCO3 minus is staying in the water, and H plus is competing with the CO3 carbonate ions, which the corals and mollusks and other organisms needs to incorporate to their shells. And so with increasing CO2, the organismic carbonization is more and more difficult until it becomes impossible. So there is a modeling that with increasing temperature caused by CO2, there is there's a trajectory of increasing carbonate ion concentration, and that will lead under some threshold to physical or chemical impossibility of carbonization by corals and switching to coral-free ecosystems, which of course would be huge loss for biodiversity. Okay, and that's where we will stop for the coral reef exposure.